Hello everyone! In this video, I am going to show you how I made a solar cell from very basic materials such as toothpaste, sweet cherry juice and tincture. Dye-sensitized solar cell is a new type of flexible solar cells. Its inventor, Michael Gredstad, was awarded Millennium Technology Prize for his invention. The first component needed for the production of such a solar cell is titanium dioxide. You can either buy it in a pure form or try to extract it from toothpaste. When going to the supermarket, I was specifically looking for the toothpaste which contained titanium dioxide. It is added to toothpaste as a white pigment. Besides, this chemical can be found not only in toothpaste, but also in dyes, creams, ointments and other cosmetics. Nevertheless, after buying such a toothpaste, I found out that besides titanium oxide, there were lots of impurities. So, I decided to extract pure titanium dioxide by rinsing it with 10% sodium hydroxide solution. In toothpaste, colloidal silica is used as an abrasive. In other words, it is very fine sand, which can dissolve in alkali solution at high temperatures. I decided to mix the solution with a whisk for milk. After that, I decided to conduct decantation. Having separated sediment, which clearly contains titanium dioxide. However, upon further filtration, very tiny titanium dioxide particles and the remains of silicon dioxide clogged the filter, which made filtration practically impossible, so I had to quit doing that. I decided to end extracting titanium dioxide from toothpaste and proceeded to using pure titanium dioxide, which I had bought earlier, in order to be able to check whether or not this method of making solar cells is effective. Besides titanium dioxide, you'll also need to get conductive glass. One side of it is sprayed with a thin layer of tin and indium oxide mixture. You can check conductivity of such a glass with a multimeter set to resistance mode. By the way, you can use an old smartphone sensor screen for that. The side covered in oxide mixture will be resistant, whereas the other side won't react when multimeter is applied to it. Such glass is the only expensive part of such a solar cell, which cannot be made at home. Of course, in theory, I could have sprayed glass or plastic with a thin layer of metal, for instance with silver, but I decided to make things easier and bought this glass from Chinese retailer. Now I need to make a paste from titanium dioxide, which will serve as a semiconductor in such a DIY solar cell. To do that, I am mixing a small amount of titanium oxide with a diluted nitric acid solution. Instead of this solution, you can also use a 70% vinegar solution in order for the paste to be more even. At the first attempt, I made a very thick paste, and later on I regret that. Paste should be spread on glass only after scotch tape has been stuck on it, in order for titanium dioxide layer to be the same thickness as the thickness of the scotch tape around. Once titanium dioxide has been spread, it is better to remove scotch tape, while titanium dioxide paste is still moist, because when it hardens and scotch tape is being removed, it can break. That is why at the first attempt I ended up having such flaws. At the second attempt, I managed to get more even shapes. When paste has been spread on the glass, it is time for the most important stage, that is, baking titanium dioxide film on the surface of the glass to make it harder. However, most manuals and articles I have read state that it is enough to just heat the film on a hot plate at high temperature. Besides, there is no exact information about the temperature or time of baking. That is why I had to do it through trial and error, so to say. At the first attempt, I heated the glass on a hot plate at the maximum temperature of about 400 degrees Celsius for about 20 minutes. It looked quite well. The next stage is soaking baked titanium dioxide film in bright sweet cherry juice, which contains natural dye anthocyanins. In my case, I use sweet cherry. Its juice is rich in natural dyes. I squeezed juice out of sweet cherries, poured it on the wash glass, and dipped the coated glass into it. 5 minutes into soaking, I noticed that titanium film just got wet and even came off one piece of glass, which is something no manual I read mentioned. Upon further rinsing of juice off the glass, I noticed that the oxide film completely came off. I had no choice but to start making paste again. This time I have heated coated glass on a hot plate over an alcohol burner, which according to the reading of the pyrometer was heated up to 450 degrees Celsius. No matter how diligently I tried, titanium dioxide film would always come off upon submersion into juice. Next time I decided to simply heat glass over an alcohol burner, thinking that maybe this time it will bake properly. However, the same thing happened over and over again. I even started wondering if I was sold a real titanium oxide or something different. Or maybe cherry juice was too acidic, maybe temperature was too low, or the film too thick. Next time I decided to heat glass over a powerful gas burner and hoped that 500 degrees Celsius for 30 minutes was enough for the oxide film. After cooling off and soaking in juice, the oxide layer hardened enough. 10 minutes into soaking, the oxide film began changing color because anthocyanins molecules began sinking into the pores. Now I'm rinsing it with water and then with pure alcohol in order for it to dry quicker air. Finally, I have at least one component needed for assembling a dye-synthesized solar cell. The next stage is preparing the other piece of glass, which will serve as an anode. It needs to be coated in a layer of graphite or carbon, which will be catalyst of the reaction. I'm just passing this piece of glass through a candle flame, and I can see soot start forming on the surface, and this soot is pure carbon. In the end, you need to make a sandwich consisting of the two pieces of glass, placing them a bit off each other's edges, leaving space for attaching electrodes, and press them together with a binder clips. To work properly, this DIY solar cell needs electrolyte containing triiodide ions and tincture of iodine you can buy at a Russian pharmacy, and it will work perfectly fine. The thing is, it is not only contains iodine dissolved in alcohol, but also water and potassium iodide, thus increasing solubility of iodine in water, which is why it vaporizes worse from the solution. After adding electrolyte, I am connecting electrodes to the solar cell and also to the multimeter in order to measure voltage. But I got totally confused. At first, multimeter showed normal reading, but when the titanium dioxide was lit by light, voltage would decrease. When I changed polarity, I found out that it wasn't a solar cell, it was just a battery, which produced voltage even in the dark, which will increase further upon adding of iodine electrolyte. I decided that it was enough for the first day of experimenting and decided to leave that until tomorrow to do everything differently and take time to think about what was happening. On next day, I made two more glass pieces coated in titanium dioxide, but that time I made the paste more liquid and also added liquid soap to it in order to moist the glass better. I was heating the glass for 30 minutes at about 500 degrees Celsius. Such an intense heat made titanium dioxide a bit yellowish. That happened because this chemical has thermochromic property. This means that if titanium dioxide powder is heated to the high temperatures, it will turn a bit yellowish, and if cooled down, it turns white again. Zinc oxide, for instance, has the same property. This time I was soaking oxide in raspberry juice for about 5 minutes. After rinsing with water and alcohol, I assembled one more dye-synthesized solar cell from two pieces of glass. You need to be very careful when doing this, because the carbon film of the second piece of glass is even more tender than titanium dioxide, and it is not durable. First, I decided to test the slightly damaged cell. For activation, I filled it with an iodine electrolyte. just like the last time, the whole thing didn't go to plan, and for some reason it showed negative current. In other words, it worked as a battery with reversed polarities, even though polarities were wired correctly. It is noteworthy that when polarities of the multimeter were changed, the cell responded only to a very bright ultraviolet torch. All of this seemed very strange to me. But then I thought that maybe alcohol in the cell's electrolyte triggered its catalytic oxidation, and that is why polarities changed. Ideally, to make this electrolyte, ethylene glycol needs to be used as a solvent. Also, the same thing happened to the other solar cell, but in some time ethanol slowly began evaporating and wasting. So, in about 40 minutes, the cell more or less stabilized, and it turned from a battery into a solar cell. Finally, at least one thing worked. When I pointed my torch, my DIY solar cell showed 60 mV voltage and 40 microampere current. Of course, this reading isn't very serious, but this cell was made at home from scrap materials. Commercial dye synthesized solar cells are usually thousands of times more efficient. So, how do these cells work? When light hits the surface of anthocyanin molecules, which are attached to the titanium dioxide grid, the dye molecules lose electrons, which pass through semiconducting titanium dioxide film, leaving holes. These holes or spaces lacking electrons are occupied by the unpaired electrons, which iodide ions have, which are oxidized into triiodide ions, which then diffuse through the carbon film on the other electrode, and then reduce again, accepting new electrons. This is how current travels inside a circuit. After running all these experiments, out of curiosity, I decided to substitute titanium dioxide with regular toothpaste and just bake it on a current conductive glass. Will such a primitive solar cells work? I went through all the stages I had done before, spread the paste and bake it for the 30 minutes over a burner. As I was baking, all the organic materials were disappearing and I was left only with a layer of silicon dioxide and titanium dioxide. Later, to my surprise, when I added raspberry juice, the oxide layer didn't come off. When I assembled the cell, it also began working strangely and turned into a battery too. About 50 minutes later, it also stabilized, and tada, it too worked as well as the other cell with pure titanium dioxide. It seemed to me that it performed even better. Apparently, the small amount of titanium dioxide that toothpaste contains is enough to make a semiconductor and move electrons. This was so due to the fact that titanium dioxide and silicon dioxide have a porous structure which prevents electrolyte from evaporating too quickly. In the sunlight, voltage and current readings were a bit higher than in torchlight. Here you can clearly see how the angle at which light shines impacts efficiency of the solar cell. I think it will be great to run this experiment at schools and universities. Pupils will be able to make solar cell with their own hands, without using expensive equipment needed to produce silicon solar cells. Of course, at this point, this type of solar cells cannot compete with silicon or other solar cells based on non-organic materials. However, scientists are slowly modernizing them. For instance, berry juice can be substituted with more efficient ruthenium complexes, and expensive glass can be substituted with current conducting plastic, and so on. By the way, the solar cell with toothpaste remained working even 12 hours later. Maybe in the future, solar energy will become more affordable, thanks to one of my subscribers. I'll be happy to see that happen.